Boss Talk 101. Yeah, we gon' talk, we gon' have fun. We be on fire, we be lit. It's a unique hustle, big shit. Big shit, big shit, big shit. It's a unique hustle, nigga, big shit. Big shit, big shit, big shit. Name another podcast like this.
Check it. It's a unique hustle. It's your boy, ECEO, and I'm here with the lovely, official, amazing Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Nothing, my dad. Walk on.
Hey, man. Say, man, we down here in H-Town, man. And, hey, man, we ran into a jewel, man. Somebody done dropped us. Hey, man, dropped us off in here, man. Big Pud done opened it up to, hey, man, we finna interview everybody in Houston, man. Check it, man. Hey, man, we got Big Pud. How you doing, brother?
Man, I'm blessed, bro.
Big Pud Entertainment.
P.U.D Entertainment, man.
Man, yeah. I say Big Pud, it's yours, man.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and it's crazy because, you know, the name is actually Big Pup, but everybody calls
for
me
real.
Pud.
That's what I was wondering because when Renetta, hold on, when Renetta texted me, she said Big Pud, but then she put Pud Entertainment. I'm like, hold on, Big Pud, but that don't go with that. And how does that work?
So how does that happen?
Well, see, P.U.P., that's my name. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Big Pud, that's what I go by.
Who gave you that name?
My mom, actually. You know what I'm saying? God bless the dead. She
why she called you Pup?
Man, you know, she called me Pup since I was really a baby.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know how kids, and they sit and they hot chair.
Yeah.
They don't. You know, they don't use silverware.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So I was eating my food like
with your hand.
So she was saying, you know, I ate my food
like a
puppy dog.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That name just kind of stayed.
Dope.
And then as I grew older, you know, I took the P.Y. off and I became a big fella. So it was just kind of added.
That's
together.
What's up.
But that's how the name came about. But Pud, that's where I'm from. I'm from Missouri City, most
okay,
City.
Okay.
And they call it Pud?
And it's a section in Ridgemont, you know what I'm saying, where that's just called Pud. It was a planned urban development. It's called HUD now, you know
okay.
what I'm saying?
Yeah, of course.
They changed it, you know what I'm saying? So Pud was a section in Ridgemont that, which was where my section was, you know what I'm saying? It was three areas inside of Ridgemont that at the time that they built. It's four of them now, which is why you get the term Ridgemont 4.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But Pud Park is my section, you know what I'm saying? So that's where I was born. That's where I was raised. I was born in Third Ward, but I grew up and I was raised in Missouri City.
How old were you when you left Missouri City?
Well, I left Missouri City. Man, my house caught on fire in 2003.
How?
2003.
No, how? Did you leave something on a stove?
Nah, it wasn't me. It was my neighbor.
Come on, bro.
Man, my neighbor barbecued the day before.
Okay.
Right?
The grease.
Nah, the charcoal.
He left the charcoal.
He dumped the charcoal in my trash can next to my house.
Wow.
The day after. He didn't put water on it or nothing, so the charcoal
got up under the
right by the attic, caught the insulation.
So was it his house and your house got burned down, or just
it's
yours?
Just mine.
And he did it.
Yeah, he did it.
Did insurance cover it?
Oh, we was good. You know what I'm saying? I moved.
Because I'd be wondering with certain things like that if the insurance company, you know, to be like, well, you must have did that.
Yeah. It was an accident. It wasn't. You know, on me.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, we was good. It was a lot of. It was a lot of events that happened around that time. You know, like I honestly, at that time, I was doing the extracurricular activities.
Yeah, for sure, in the streets, baby.
And you know,
why do everybody as kids? It's like everybody we've been interviewing, that's where they went.
What, in the street?
Well, you're right.
Well,
why?
Man, because the streets be calling you. Nigga, the niggas in the hood. Everybody.
Can't you like, I'm not listening?
No, we prone
well, see,
to
I'm
it.
I'm going to tell you what you hear. You hear your mama dropping tears on bills.
Real
you know
talk.
What I'm saying?
She was a single mom?
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? You hear crying at night because she can't pay things. You
yes,
know what
sir.
I'm saying? And when you see that as a child, man, you like you're gonna do everything you can right then to help that. You know what I'm saying?
Are you the first boy?
I'm not. I'm the youngest boy. I'm the youngest of two.
But you know what I mean? See, and you would think that wouldn't fall on your shoulders, it would fall on the eldest shoulders.
You would. You would.
Yeah, yeah. Don't say that, because usually sometimes you don't never know who going to be the one. I'm going to say this, you know, because I get real spiritual, you know. Really, Esau wasn't supposed to be the one. It was supposed to be Jacob. Right. I mean, it's supposed to be Esau, not Jacob. Right. So the younger one, a lot of times, they spiral that. They flip that thing around. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Instead of Manasseh and Ephraim, they had to switch places, Joseph's son. So it's always that's I'm saying that for me too, nigga. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
because I'm
you know, I know what's going on, and I commend you, brother. I already know. Yeah, it flipped on him. Yeah.
I mean, you know, my
mom, ain't nothing wrong with it.
Man, it's nothing. I don't regret any decision I made. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
It made you the person that you are today.
Right, and I learned from him. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, every what they say, every test is a lesson.
What you talk
about is
a blessing.
Yes, sir.
So, you know, everything I went through, it's a blessing for me.
Man,
it's
a blessing. So when you think about, you know, just coming up in H-Town, man.
Hold on.
I wanted to ask a question.
No, I know, but I want you to get there. But
okay, you see how she
do. We want to still be in
you see,
Missouri.
What kind of podcast is
but
this?
But hold on. But people love the real.
Right. Yeah,
so, okay, so Missouri, because the house burnt up, but... Is that reason why you left Missouri? Because then, you know, you were just buying another house there in Missouri.
Well,
why leave?
At the time, you know, we had to go for what was available. You know what I'm saying? So there was no houses in that area, you know, that we seen that was available. So we ended up moving not far from it. You know what I mean? But I had been there since 1988.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, my whole childhood, teenage years was there, and I still go back. You know what I mean? Like, I do giveaways in my hood.
That's
we do
good.
A lot of things. You know what I'm saying? Like, so it's, this is, you know, Pud is my hood, man. You know what I'm saying? So I'm always showing love, and I put this stamp on me to bring to the world so they'll know what Pud is about.
Dope.
You know what I'm saying?
Dope. My thing, I was just going to ask about the size of Houston, because a lot of people, when they come to Houston, I go straight downtown. I ain't going to lie to you. You know what I'm talking about? I know already if I go downtown, I'll be like, I'm in Houston. I just want to get a picture of the big back skyscrapers and all that good stuff. But just kind of break down the dynamics of H-Town.
H-Town, man, with downtown, you can go in any direction on the outskirts of downtown, and you're going to be in a hood.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So you go southeast of downtown, you're going to run in the third ward. You know what I'm saying? You go east of downtown, you're going to run in the fifth ward. You know what I mean? Then you go north, all that right there. Well, let me say northeast of downtown, fifth ward. Either way you go, it's hoods right around downtown.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? And then... South, well, we got South Park, we got Third Ward, South Park, South Acres, all that going down 288. You got Southwest, you know what I'm saying? Southeast, it's so many. You know, you have to break down the size because Houston is so big. You know what I'm saying? Because you can't just go north, southeast, and west. You know what I mean? It's southeast, southwest, northeast, northwest. Of course, north, east, south, and west. You know
I ain't gonna lie to you. Back in the days, I went straight to Harlem Nights. You know what I'm saying? I was selling clothes in front of it when I first came home. Don't worry about that. I was a young cat. I come out here to get my money, and I would go straight over there and start selling clothes. That's when you know you got a heart. You go to every city, and you go say, hey, man, you know, I got this. That's why I know I was different. I come to Houston. I go to Dallas, or either I go to East Texas or Shreveport. Yeah. I was like, just like you were selling the CDs, I was selling the clothes.
That's the gorilla.
You see what I'm saying?
That's the gorilla grind, man.
That's what landed me there. It was a nice place, nice time too. I would stop in there often and sit around. You know what I mean?
But I keep talking about the city. I know that in Dallas they're fixing up a lot of the hoods, trying to
gentrify.
Right. So because when we were looking for somewhere to stay out here, downtown of course was the number one spot. Right. But when you think about this spot over here is in Third Ward. I'm like, I heard about Third Ward. I'm like, nah. Fifth Ward, I'm like, nah. But are there any good places in those areas? Is it just all hood?
They have almost completely gentrified Second Ward.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Almost completely.
That's
dope. You know what I mean? And it's cool.
Is they giving the people living areas? Like the ones who were originally there? That's what I don't like
about
it.
That's the problem.
I don't like that.
That's the problem. But no, they're not. But there's also They're working on Third Ward now. You know what I'm saying?
So they're pushing the people out of certain.
And that's the thing out. I was about to ask too. Like, because I've always hear people talk about this. I said when they gentrify these areas, they run all the black folks out, and it's white folks who's coming in
because they build properties that raise that's tax right. value. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Property value, and those people can't pay those taxes, mm-hmm. so they have to, you know, they have to go. And then, because you can't pay the taxes on your home now, you got to forfeit it. You got to give it up.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Dope. Let me ask you something about just the music, man. Yeah. When you think of Houston, Texas is a pinnacle for Texas when it come down to, with the screw. They originated the screw. And then you got Jay Prince down here. Jay Prince actually brought not just to Houston, but to the South. He brought recognition to hip hop, and just when you started off in the music here, what drove you into getting into that? You know,
Music itself. Like my pops was a guitarist, so okay. I was in music. You know what I mean? But the influences of music. You know what I'm saying? Like I was always a Scarface, Ghetto Boys fan. You know what I'm saying? So you know, Jay Prince bought something huge as an influence as an artist to me, and as a CEO.
Dope.
You know what I'm saying?
Business guy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Definitely a great business mind.
Yeah, you know, yeah.
But the music side, even when Draper was down here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I remember that, Tony Draper, yeah.
So A-Ball MJG were big influences as well.
Yeah, you know dope music. Yeah, man, whatever happened to that? It was a guy named Mr. Mike.
Mr. Mike, man. That's big homie, man.
That's
man.
A long time ago,
he's still
boy.
Out here. He's still
he's
out
still
here.
In the H.
Yeah,
okay.
He's still out here, man.
So like you, when did you first start taking it? Like my livelihood. This how I'm gonna do things.
The livelihood. I could say this. I've taken music serious since 2000.
Okay.
And that's for rapping, right?
That's rapping, yeah. Okay. I've always taken music serious since then. My personal influence.
And how old were you at 2002?
2000, how old am I now?
Okay, calculate.
So what's this, 21? Mm-hmm. Probably 16, 17.
Okay.
16, 17.
Okay.
But like my personal influence was like, it was people around me that I could see. So I had the Street Militaries, the group Street Military.
Okay.
Lil Flea. And then Zero, because we're from the same neighborhood.
Okay, got it, got it.
So, you know, Zero was a big influence in me, you know, actually taking music serious. Because it's a guy that lived right down the street from me that was taking it extremely serious. You know what I'm saying? And then I seen what he was doing with it, not just because he wasn't successful when he inspired me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He was just doing it consistently.
Who was it? Can you say his name on
Zero.
Oh, it was Zero.
Yeah.
Because when I seen Zero when we first came on scene, it was weird, kind of. It was like he had this type of the people that he covered was isolated to him. I'm being real. Like, it wasn't like the Hispanics. It was like his own little, it was like a cult almost to me. When I seen it, when I came to Houston, nigga be like, get that Zero. I'm like, I don't know Zero. But then when you listen to it, you can't out rap the nigga. Like, the nigga rapping hard, like that's singing, harmonizing.
You can never take that from that brother is tough.
So you couldn't talk down on Texas when you listen to Zero. And then that people like Zero, I put them in categories where you put anybody, Scarface, Zero, you put them in the booth somewhere, I'm putting my money on them niggas, man. Because you're not going to go out now and I rap these dudes, man. You know what I'm saying? Like I knew that already. And J-Daw, I can't forget about that. J-Daw be in hometown.
J-Daw tough.
I like J-Daw, man. That's street, man.
Yeah, J-Daw tough. But yeah, man, those guys were the influences for me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I just kept it, you know.
Did he talk to you?
Bro,
yeah, in the neighborhood and stuff, y'all was hanging out. And
I mean, back then.
I'm talking about back then.
Back then, you know, we were like the first person because we freestyled a lot. You know, in my neighborhood, we just kick rhymes off the dome. But that's the first person I ever heard put a hook to a freestyle. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So we'd be freestyling, him and my older brother, they'd be in the room freestyling, and Zero would do a hook. And then somebody else would start freestyling. Mm-hmm, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So he would lean over to you and like, hey, man, check this hook out. You know what I'm saying? See if you like it or whatnot. You know what I mean? And So yeah, we like I've known Zero personally, just outside of music, you know, pretty much since I was a kid.
How's he business wise? I mean, as far as when y'all working together, he's straight. He got to be focused. He was producing.
Oh yeah, yeah. Ro is, he's definitely serious about his craft.
Like, yeah,
you know what I'm saying. He's definitely serious about his craft. Like that's his livelihood.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. So you know, if you know a nigga try to do anything with what pays your bills, you'd be serious about it too. You know, so
for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
For
sure. You know, he's definitely serious about his craft, and yeah, I think. Like, you know, he, like, from what he's done to then to now, you know, mm-hmm. like, I still chop it up with him to this day, you know.
For sure.
He's, you know, he's actually giving me a lot of advice on what I'm doing now, you know what I mean? And it just, you know, how to deal with certain people, what not to, you know what I mean? So, because he's done a lot.
He has a long history of dealing with, and he was signed to rap a lot, right?
Right.
So now, is he independent now?
He's independent.
That's a whole nother ball game.
Right.
When you start to look at the way the world's changed.
Right.
I often talk about, you know, certain people that be saying like, you know, this dude screwed this dude, or this dude, when it come to the people like the Jay Princes or the Jay Z's or the Birdmans.
Right.
But over time, evolution, things change, bro. And you grow, and you really got to enjoy the movement. Most time people be so caught up in the fact of what people are saying outside, trying to put stigmas on situations, that I feel like it makes things worse than what they really have to be.
Right, right. And then me as an artist, I'm an artist.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm an artist first.
First, okay. You know what I'm saying? Got it.
And then I became a CEO.
Okay.
So the thing is, me being a CEO, an artist, I seen the fuckeries.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But I seen it happen to other artists.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I kind of learned from other people's mistakes. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And how old were you when you became a CEO?
I started my label in 2006.
Okay.
I actually incorporated it, you know, did the actual business on
yes,
it.
Yes, sir.
In like 2010.
Okay.
You know, and what inspired you to start a label rather than just be an artist? And how hard was it?
I've always had a business mindset.
You yes, know what sir. I'm
saying? Even when I did the wrong things, it was a business mindset to it. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, had they would have caught me, it would have been more of a kingpin type of mentality.
Yeah, yeah.
Than just somebody's on the corner.
That's right. This,
because that's the mindset I had. But in music, it was just about, I seen a problem. And I wanted to do something to fix it.
Mm-hmm.
And that was that, particularly in my city, didn't know business.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And not just your city.
A lot of cities.
It was everywhere. And it's still dominant in certain areas. And that's just a part of I believe that you got Google now. Do your research. But
it's not hard.
But
it's
at the end of the day, a lot of people just
lazy.
Just like spirituality. Right. You know, a lot of people tell you the white man wrote the Bible. I ain't never read the Bible. You know what I'm saying? Like it's just, it's the same thing. Like my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge.
For the lack of knowledge.
That's
definitely.
Serious,
definitely.
Bro.
Definitely.
They want somebody else to tell them what to do instead of actually researching for themselves.
That's one aspect. And then you have people that want you to
do it for them. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so that's
boy, that hit home. You might be a preacher. They don't want you to do it for.
They want you to do it for them, man. And again, you know, it's a lot of things. See, Houston. Well, I can speak on Houston. I can't really speak on other cities. Granted, they might the variables might fit those other cities.
There you go. But you know what you live.
Yeah, for Houston, like we know the hustle. We know the game of music. We didn't know the business of music. The only person I can say who did was Jay.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But people here don't really know the business of music, and that's what takes away. So when you know the hustle of music, you know a hustler.
Yeah.
We trying to get it right now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And we'll get it off our brother if we have to.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
But in business, you eat with your brother.
That's exactly.
It. You know what I'm saying? You don't have to. See, I take the actual business side kind of flows to me like corporations, because it is a corporation.
Correct.
So when you go to work, Do your coworkers pay you, or do that corporation pay you?
The corporation.
The corporation pays you. In Houston, how these artists are, they're trying to eat off the next artist.
Wow.
The next artist. You know what I'm saying? He coming up, he doing a little something, and then you got people that's cliques that want to rock with you because you might be doing, making a little noise, doing this and that. But working together, using the business format, everybody eats.
Yes.
But that's one thing I can't stand about this industry. And I'm not going to say this industry, because to me, Atlanta have it pat, because they work together. And I would love to see Texas. I'm not going to say Houston. I want to say Texas. Yeah. Because since I've been here in Texas, it's always been a Houston thing, a Dallas thing. San Antonio, Austin. Right. Texas is huge. Imagine what impact we would have if we all came together and worked together as a...
PMC said that, didn't he?
Man, an artist can go platinum in Texas alone.
And I know that. He can do it right here.
He don't have to go nowhere.
But let me ask you this, and I want to understand, like, because you had the rec shops, you had all the...
Right.
I was upset with Houston for a minute, too, because I was mad, because I knew that they had a situation where they had the screw tape, the regular tape. They were making double the money. I say this every episode when I talk about Houston. Then these niggas decided they want to be like everybody else. That pissed me off. I was like, man, we were winning.
Because
when you said, you might have said Houston, nigga, but I'm with y'all. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. I don't care. Like, I'm looking at I'm looking at it from an oval, and I'm like, dang, this is because it filtered into Dallas. It filtered into these other Austin.
Right.
And y'all love Austin, too. Y'all would run down to Austin. Austin is like Houston. You know?
Because it's right there.
And Corpus, too, man. Austin and Corpus was.
But what happened to that, man?
Man, you said it.
They want to be like everybody else. They didn't have to. They was even doing better than everybody else.
We had the biggest cultural movement in the South.
Yeah.
With that. Especially once artists started to get on, and then they started using the screw samples.
Yeah, that's still dope. 2005,
2006 era. We was on top, but also we failed because we didn't know business.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We failed because of that. Then once after that, everybody else started taking the style that we did, we created, using it for their benefit, making platinum songs off of it, but they had their business right.
Okay.
So they benefited from
it. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Outside of Texas, outside of Houston. And then we wanted to be like everybody else.
I know it, man. And I thought I was the man, too. I was like, we winning. When I get a screw tape, then I get me a regular CD. I get both of them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm double dibbing. That's what y'all was doing. Yeah. And then they just switched it up. I was like, man, what the heck happened to that movement?
Mm-hmm. Man, I mean, in the streets, we still, even me as an artist, every artist I drop a slow and chop version.
You do?
You know what I'm saying?
That's dope.
Even my records, I drop a slow and chop version of it. You know,
that's
what I'm
dope.
Keep it Houston.
Just to keep the vibe, mm-hmm. the culture. You know, what I'm saying?
And you look back at the ones who paved the way, who worked toward that,
definitely.
And you got to do it if you in Pay Houston, homage, right?
Yeah. Definitely. And you know, rest in peace, DJ Screw. There's not many like that sound for like that Screw DJ Screw sound. Everybody's slowing it up. Everybody chopping it. But DJ Screw, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's not many people that have that sound. Even Michael Watts. Like, Michael Watts has Michael. It's Screw. It's slowed down. It's not Screw because it's not Screw. But it's slowed down. It's slowed and chopped. But, like, the artists that I like, Screw had mixes.
Yeah.
The way he'll mix into a chop, the way he scratches into a chop, it was different. And I got to shout out DJ Red because he's like the closest one to that.
I was about to ask you that.
I was just about to ask about DJ Screw. Did he have any children?
I'm not sure. I think Screw did have kids.
Because I'd be always wondering, when you make such a great impact, that, you know, you'd want your kids to carry on with your legacy.
Right.
So I was wondering if he had any children that actually like try to, you know, step in that.
Yeah, shoe. I'm not really sure. I can't, you know, quote that, don't quote me on that, because I don't want to, you know, say he did and he didn't and vice versa, but if so, I've never heard of any of his children following the, you know what I'm saying?
The legacy or the footsteps.
But of the screwed up clique, DJ Red is the the official screwed up DJ.
Do you feel like as of now? Well, I ask you this: when music translated over into the digital world, how were you able to cope with that? What did you and I know you're seeing certain people fall back, but what did you do to carry on the legacy for PUD Entertainment?
I actually, man, see. You know, like I said, I'm from that era of guerrilla hustling.
Correct.
So, man, even then, I didn't sell a bunch of records out the store.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I wasn't part of that era. I was right in between of the shift. You know what I'm
okay.
saying? So when I actually started to move records, I was out the trunk.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I did see a lot of money that way. But when the digital world came, I was on streaming platforms in 06.
Okay.
Before a lot of other people, like, that knew about it.
Yeah.
So I learned the streaming platforms.
Okay.
I learned about algorithms.
Mm-hmm.
I learned about how your name could be attached to another name, and that name alone would give you more recognition.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I started doing mixtapes with, you know, with other artists that had names.
Yeah.
Doing features with other artists that had names and throwing them out there, throwing the mixtapes out there. At that time, they wasn't so monitored to where you couldn't use, you didn't have to have a license to use certain things. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
They wasn't. But now, you know, it won't even go on the platform if you're not licensed. You can't get a Jeezy verse and throw it out there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You got to have rights to use it and so forth. And you did then, but they wasn't strict about it then. So it was just about having different mixtapes, throwing them out there. So I learned the algorithms of how streaming platforms work.
Okay, let me ask you this. Who is, and did you have anything
yes.
you want to say?
Go ahead. I wanted to go back a little bit. I know you said that your father was not in your, well, you were raised by your single mom.
Right.
Where was your dad?
My dad was, man, you know, Papa was Rolling Stone.
Yeah, I get
you
it.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he, and today me and my dad have a cool relationship.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We good. I think
but
we have.
But then you didn't have.
But then he wasn't there. You know what I'm saying? He wasn't there. So, you know.
Do you think that impacted your life as a young boy growing up?
I think when a household doesn't have both parents, it's impactful.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of how it impacts, whether it's negatively or positively, it's impactful. So did it impact my life? Definitely. But I would say that it made me a more determined man.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? It made me more determined to be there for my family.
So, because a lot of people I know become rebellious and start to act out and do all
and
of that sort of
I
stuff.
I was never that with my pops. I was never rebellious. You know, I had, you know, and to this day, I'm not. You know what I'm saying? But did I condone what he did? No, I don't. You know what I'm saying? Do I understand what he did? To an extent, but it doesn't
so you
justify
did
it.
Ask him why weren't you there?
Before
and stuff
my
like
mom
that.
Passed, I've had conversations with her. I had conversations with my pops. Like, as a child, you have to get the understanding of your parents before you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
So you can understand why you are.
Exactly.
You know
exactly.
What I mean? So I did that. I had
and
those
what
conversations.
You want to break that you don't
right.
want it passed down.
Right, right. You definitely don't want to, you know, because my generation of, my family
mm-hmm.
before me, we didn't come from, you know, generational wealth. We didn't come from knowledge of wealth.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? We didn't come from knowledge of financing. You know what I'm saying? Or finances. We didn't come
from
any of
that.
But a lot
of black families don't educate their kids on finances.
Well, a lot of black families don't have the education on finances.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
So, with that being that, that's what I wanted to break. You know what I'm saying?
Dope.
That's the
bridge.
That's the, yeah.
And you have a child, right?
I do.
How old?
She's 13. She'll be 13 in November.
Dope.
Oh, okay. And you're with the mom?
No, I'm not. I'm not with the mom.
So you have that broken home again.
Right, right. But what we co-parent. We're very good at that.
Yeah.
There's no, because me, my mom didn't deal with my dad at all.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? We was here with that. Complete separation.
So you see something coming together somewhat.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but granted, I'm not with my child's mother,
mm-hmm.
but we do the absolute best at co-parenting. We have an understanding that to hell with what we going through.
Exactly.
It's her. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
I think, like I said, man, you just describing a lot of brothers that's, you know what I mean, coming up in the inner city, right? Right. Like, people go through things, and that's what make you, what don't kill you make you stronger.
Stronger.
And I know that to be a fact. You know me, I'm going to fast forward right back into the music.
Go ahead.
I want to ask you about just UGK and their impact on the whole Houston culture and what they mean to it.
Yeah, well, UGK is definitely important to, you know, Southern Texas, period.
There you go.
You know what I'm saying?
History.
You know,
yeah, because they out of, of course, they're Port Arthur, but they was with Jay Prince and everybody
else. They rep Houston. Yes, sir. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, Bun reps Houston. He lives out here.
Yes.
You know, he so loved the PA, and he so loved the Houston. You know what I'm saying?
Dope.
So, impactful. Very impactful.
I remember like Jay Prince told a story about how when he first heard that, was it Too Hard to Swallow, that first album, that he drove fast as he could down there because he wanted to, you know, sign him and just be with him and just love what he had heard in that album, man.
They were an iconic group, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah.
You can't mention Southern music without UGK. They are the kings of the underground. Like, it's no question with that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They have made so much influence, so many influences, and such a big impact in just Southern, not just Houston, Texas, Texas alone, Louisiana, Mississippi. You got Crit. You wouldn't have Crit if it wasn't for UGK.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
You know, so
I definitely agree.
Do you know Bun personally?
I know Bun a few. I've
been in the same room.
Yeah. Well, like, he's done records for my artists. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I call Bun, like, he's on Big Frat's Afraid remix with him and Zero. You know what I'm saying? So he's on another one of my artists, Dougie D, who's from Gorilla Mob. I don't know if y'all are the group Gorilla Mob, but that's Trey, Zero, Dougie D.
Correct.
That's Gorilla Mob. Dougie is one of my artists now. You know what I'm saying?
So dope.
He's on the single So Hard with Dougie. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So I wanted to know, is there a story that you can enlighten us on of something that maybe Bun told you about, or just, you know,
or a way to the influence?
Or a way,
yeah,
right.
I could say more of an influence, because me and Bun hadn't had any
interaction,
conversation. We talked, but you know what I'm saying, like, just in depth conversation. To where something he's just, you know, it would be something I took from it. You know what I mean?
That's right.
But I took a lot from his career, though.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
you're a professor or something now, ain't
you? Yeah, he was at U of H.
That's dope. Yeah.
But just the biggest thing with Bun that I could take away from what he's done is consistency.
Dope.
Consistency. Bun never stops.
Dope.
You know what I'm saying? He never stops.
Do you think that when you look at just overall, when you look at, like, back in the days, the Big Hawks, the Fat Pats, you know what I'm saying? R.I.P. to them boys, man.
Definitely.
That whole time, that was a different time for me. You know what I mean? That was a whole movement in itself.
That was the golden age of Houston.
Right. That's why I said Austin a while ago, because I thought about Fat Pat.
Yeah.
I was like, man, I remember, you know, he was frequenting down there in Austin.
Yeah, I mean, they loved him out there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They loved him out there. Man, like, Hawk was, man, Hawk, I met Hawk probably like 4-5 times. The first time I conversated with Hawk, I was on a three-way call with him and Zero.
Okay.
And Ro was like, hold on, I'm finna call Hawk. He called Hawk. This was probably like 2002.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And then, he was like, man, I'm finna call Hawk. I think they had a show. You know what I'm saying? And he was asking Hawk, can he do one of the songs that he got with Zero? And, man, Hawk was such a humble, cool person, man. Like, he was, he told Ro, he said, you know, I'm getting paid for this show. Bro getting paid for this show. At that time, man, we probably getting like $500-$600 for a show.
Mm-hmm.
He told him, man, you know, I'll see, you know, what he can get you for. He said, man, Bro, don't worry about that, man. Get your money. I'm going to come through for you.
Already.
You know what I'm saying?
That's dope.
And you know, Hawk at the time having the bigger name, you know what I mean? And he's just going to come and make this appearance for Ro. Do this song that he did with Ro at his show for nothing.
Bro,
you know what I'm saying? And you know, that let me know that Hawk was a real general, man. He was a real person. You know what I'm saying? And I actually met him a few times after that, talked to him before he passed. He actually agreed to do a song with me.
Wow.
And we never got to do it.
Yeah, but dope that y'all even had the interaction, right? Do you think people come to Houston and steal different things and go take it back home?
Think?
I know that they do.
You see what I'm saying?
We got evidence. You know what I'm saying?
I've seen you want to name one?
I'm going to take it lightly, but I'm just saying, like, I've seen guys who, when that era was going on, dipped up in here, tried to, you know, it was a plot. I seen it as a plot, you know, to separate, to conquer, because you can divide something, you can try to, you know, knock it out the box.
Right.
And I seen that, and it frustrated me. I'm not going to say no name, but I know exactly the times, because I love music. I'm a hip-hop head.
Yeah.
So, and I would see it and get so frustrated, because I'm like, oh, they fell for that. I can't believe it. Yeah. You know, it was some things with, when you look at the, I go back and look at all of the errors. I'm not going to name, because I love everybody, and I'm friends with a lot of these guys, too. But I can say that Houston has some dope, and I think people seen that, and I think it was also, it wasn't done on a way to where I'm a directly affected, but I'm going to do things to where I don't like what they got. We need that over here.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying?
Right.
We want that movement over here.
Mean, Houston was probably one of the biggest victims of the culture vulture.
Exactly.
You know what I'm
exactly.
saying? Definitely. We've had so many styles and things taken from us, or stolen, let me say it that way.
Yeah, stolen.
Stolen from us, you know what I'm saying? And they went, but again, if we had things set up the right way.
You said it earlier.
They could have never stolen.
They could have never stolen because you'd have had it right.
We'd have had it right.
What's your top three artists of all time, man? Dead or alive? That's a question I ask on every
genre.
Episode.
Dead or alive?
Any genre, too. So any we genre. Different. We across the board, number one.
Well, I love hip hop, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
So, but my top three artists of all times, I always go with Pac.
Tupac. That's a dope choice.
Pac, Face.
Number two, Face. Didn't get to talk about Face much, but that's my boy right there. Love his music.
He lives here, right?
Yeah.
You can't get a bad verse out of him. Yeah, I bet you that.
You're not going to get a bad verse out of Face at all.
Number three,
Al Green, man.
Mm, there he went back. Yeah, he went. He reached all the way back. Man.
That dude was music, man.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
I listen to him today.
And he go in, don't he?
Yeah, man. He was such a unique voice. He just like his music was music, man. You turn on Al Green, you know it's Al Green.
Dope, man.
You know what I'm saying?
I love Al Green.
Yeah, I love him too, man.
Yeah, if I had to go four, I'd say Bob Marley, and then, you know, five, I'd round out my top five.
You know I'm not letting you do all that. We only doing three. But what's up with Beyonce, man? She from down here too. Megan Thee Stallion.
Yeah, because you didn't have females on.
No, we ain't talking about that. I'm not asking him. I'm talking about, listen, only thing I'm talking about, how do you feel they, you know, move the culture in the city? Man,
ooh,
the Megan, Beyonce first, and then Megan Thee Stallion being the first rapper from Texas.
Well, I'll say Beyonce is unmatched. You know what I'm saying with what she done. You know what I'm saying and how far she took it. Megan, man, I love what Megan.
She the first rapper from Texas to blow up like that, bro.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
I ain't talking about Megan, from Houston. I'm talking about from Texas.
Megan, first female.
First female artist.
She pushed boundaries that, you know, male artists has been trying to do.
Mm-hmm. Dope, you know, man. To be a female and to do that, man, I never would have seen that coming.
Yeah.
And I didn't think about it. I think it was me and DeRoe. Mm-hmm. And we was like, she the first female. When he was on my show, I was like, you right, DeRoe. She the first one. Because we never thought about it before that.
And then, you know, and she jams. You know what I mean? Like, well, as far as her delivery is super dope. You know what I'm saying? I love, like, for instance, I'm not too big on the That Shit song. But
of course.
Her delivery on the song.
Going in.
Is crazy. It's
wow.
Crazy.
So what do you think about Erykah Banks?
Erykah Banks, I hadn't heard much of her.
She's still young in the game.
Yeah, but like the song she have, I think it's a dope hit. Like it's actually a sample of one of my favorite Nelly songs.
Oh yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
It went stupid.
Yeah. So I think it's pretty dope. You know what I'm saying? But I hadn't heard much of her
She just now started, man. So I think she got a long road ahead, but I think she's going to be dope.
So what else do you expect from your label? Like in the next 2 years, where do you see PUD Entertainment?
I see us being the pinnacle and face of what Houston business should look like.
Okay, so what you saying that, and you're still, what Houston, how are you, or do you ever plan on trying to bridge that gap between Dallas and Houston?
I was going to Dallas back in the day, so I've worked with Dallas artists a lot back then.
Mm-hmm.
I'm about togetherness, you know what I'm saying? But I know to fix a problem, you have to fix it at the source.
Yeah.
And my source is Houston. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So once I can fix it here, then, you know, maybe other people will see what's going on. And then they can, because, you know, with this music, everything is about what's trending. And if we could trend business, then we can change business.
Let me say this. You know what the pioneer of it is, the Dallas and Houston thing, far as prison, far as football teams,
football teams.
All this stuff is causing a big
rivalry.
It's always been a rivalry, but that's the fun part.
But
of
you
it.
Can have a good rivalry. Yeah, they take. Right.
I'm telling the truth. That's the core of it.
The core of it. Okay, the Dallas, the football teams, the football teams. You know what I'm saying? The basketball team, but mainly
football.
So that's supposed to be a fun rivalry.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But
friendly competition.
But when you in the can, it's niggas that watch those games.
They serious.
And it's serious. You know what I'm saying? Then you get into fights with niggas like over Dallas.
Yeah.
So then it becomes a real problem.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So
it's, people can get killed behind it.
And people have
and
gotten
people
killed,
have gotten,
you know,
killed. Yep.
So it's deeper than just music. Because I don't even think it's a problem on the music Houston Dallas scene. You know what I'm saying? I really don't.
I don't either.
I don't see the problem.
I think it's more the rivalry thing that keeps that wedge in between.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
But anyway, man, you giving us a dope interview, man. You open your doors up to us, man. Hey, man, I'm coming back.
Man,
yeah, nigga. Yeah, I set my cameras outside that door and be sitting there, nigga, just recording when you get here. You know what I'm saying?
Man, you're welcome back, man. I appreciate
thank you
coming,
so
man.
Much, man.
For real,
man. Hey, man, we love you, brother.
Man, I love you back, brother.
Yeah, man.
Real, man.
Hey, man, it's been another great segment of Boss Talk 101.
And we out.